I'm Elle, and today we come to the final part of our Rewired Soul trilogy. Since the scandal began, there have been comparisons between Chris Boutet and Peter Monn all over the place, and you guys know that I like going over old tea to make better sense of new tea. So that comparison makes sense, right? Both were addicts, both are in recovery, and both have worked with addicts. And as we all know, Peter had a major fall from grace last year. But is that comparison fair? Can Peter Monn really be compared to the Rewired Soul fairly? Really, what seems to be the most valid comparison is the exposing of old, gross social media content. So let's compare their responses. Back on the 6th of September, Peter Monn made a video where he went in depth to address his tweets, where he said this.
Well, I didn't really, honestly, know that there were this many shitty, disgusting tweets that I just didn't, you know? I'm ashamed, I'm embarrassed. It's not how I choose to live my life today, but maybe that's who I was at one point. And I need to take a look at that, you know? I need to take a look at this is maybe who I was, or this is who I was when I was tweeting those things out. And why did I tweet those things out? And like, what can I learn from it? What do I need to go back and change? So I put out some really, really disgusting, shameful tweets into the world. If I offended you, I apologize. The reason why I don't say I'm sorry, and I say this in a lot of my videos, is because to me, I'm sorry means nothing except for forget what I just did. My dad taught me that, because when I would say I'm sorry to him in the past, he would say, you just want me to forget what you did. I'm not gonna get on video and do something different because somebody wants to hear me say I'm sorry. I'm sorry means nothing to me. I take ownership and I apologize for what I did.
Whether you believe him or not, whether you forgive him or not, there was an apology given, and Peter did make it clear in that video that he thought that what he'd done was disgusting. When Chris, on the other hand, was asked about his old Facebook posts in a live stream, he said this.
I'm a person of color. I don't know if, you know, that's something that I'll address right now. I haven't been watching the drama videos on me, so you'll have to ask questions. But I heard like somebody said something about me talking about people of color. I am half African American. Okay. I'm half Sicilian, half African American. I've discussed this. So that's something that I don't understand.
Chris clearly doesn't understand. Now, I am well aware that Chris is mixed race, half African American and half Sicilian, as he describes himself. But there are women that are misogynistic. Peter Monn was dragged for using homophobic terms despite being a gay man himself. Chris doesn't get to hide behind his heritage when it came to negatively stereotyping black men, and the fact that he brushed off Islamophobia, a rape joke, and a jab at someone in a wheelchair is him just having a dark sense of humour and shrugging the whole thing off. That is not good enough for me personally. At the very, very least, Peter went online and both accepted and acknowledged that his old tweets hurt people. Like Chris, he said that he had a dark sense of humour too, but he didn't just treat other people's upset like it was nothing. Then again, Peter did claim that he was a psychotherapist, but let's rewind first. Within half an hour of my last video being live, Dr. Carrie Randazzo deleted her entire YouTube channel. Now, I don't know about anyone else, but that makes her look guilty to me personally. Why delete an entire innocent channel if there's nothing sketchy going on, right? Of course, that just made me want to dig a little bit deeper, because the fact is that Chris Boutet and Dr. Carrie Randazzo work together, and they will know all the details about each other, their credentials, and their work. We've already seen Chris introduce his mother as a professional psychologist, when that doesn't seem to ring entirely true. Since the last video, I found another piece of certification that Carrie owns. According to the California Consortium of Addiction Programs and Professionals, she seems to have the credential acronym of RADT1, which was valid from the 25th of June 2018 and is valid until the 25th of June 2019. What's particularly interesting is that there are gaps in our registry with the CCAPP. You guys can go and research the rest of those dates, but okay, what is a RADT? Pause for a second here to read this description from the Sober College of Addiction Studies. So it looks as though Carrie is only entry level in the field as far as certification is concerned right at this moment, which seems really weird to me, since on her LinkedIn, She titles herself as a professional psychologist working at the California Integrative Recovery Centers at the moment. Now, this could be a problem, because according to California regulations, in order to practice psychology in California, you will need to secure a license from the California Board of Psychology. The board has educational and work hours requirements you must complete before submitting an application to become a psychologist. You must also provide your fingerprints and undergo a background check before becoming a psychologist. California requires applicants to pass two exams, the Nationally Required Examination for Professional Practice in Psychology, EPPP, and the California Psychology Law and Ethics Examination, CPLEE. And the only license for Carrie that I can personally find through clicking those links is the license to teach that was talked about in my last video, which unfortunately for Carrie seems to violate the APA's ethics. In the APA's The Titles We Use article from 2006, letters were sent in asking about whether people using specific titles were appropriate and ethical. The link to these questions and answers are down in the description, but these sections stood out to me. APA views the manner in which psychologists convey their training and credentials as having an explicitly ethical aspect. The ethical component stems from recognizing that the psychologist-client relationship is fiduciary in nature. Because the relationship is built upon trust, honesty and openness are integral parts of the relationship. Our honesty and openness also make important information available for our clients' consideration and thus enhance our clients' ability to make more fully informed and autonomous choices about their treatment. The ethics code therefore makes honesty and openness about our training and credentials part of our ethical obligations. As an example, the ethics code emphasizes the importance of informing clients whether an individual has completed training. 10.01 Informed Consent to Therapy. Section C. When the therapist is a trainee and the legal responsibility for the treatment provided resides with the supervisor, the client/patient, as part of the informed consent procedure, is informed that the therapist is in training and is being supervised and is given the name of the supervisor. As another example, the ethics code emphasizes the importance of accuracy and transparency in conveying our credentials. 5.01 Avoidance of False or Deceptive Statements. Section A. Public statements include, but are not limited to, paid or unpaid advertising, product endorsements, grant applications, licensing applications, other credentialing applications, brochures, printed matter, directory listings, personal resumes or CVs, or comments for use in media such as print or electronic transmission, statements in legal proceedings, lectures and public oral presentations, and published materials. Psychologists do not knowingly make public statements that are false, deceptive, or fraudulent concerning their research, practice, or other work activities, or those of persons or organizations with which they are affiliated. Section B. Psychologists do not make false, deceptive, or fraudulent statements concerning 1. Their training, experience, or competence, 2. Their academic degrees, 3. Their credentials, 4. Their institutional or association affiliations, 5. Their services, 6. The scientific or clinical basis for or results or degree of success of their services, 7. Their fees, or 8. Their publications or research findings. And further down into the article, the ethics code envisions a relationship of trust between psychologists and their clients. Providing relevant information in a straightforward and transparent way can be essential to that trust and enhances our clients' autonomy by promoting more fully informed and autonomous choices. The ethics code explicitly recognizes the importance of how we present ourselves to our clients, and it is most in keeping with the ethics code when we present our credentials, often among the first pieces of information a client receives about us and the services we provide, in an ethically sensitive manner that paves the way for a clinically productive relationship. The truth is that it doesn't matter that Carrie has a PhD. She's not licensed as far as I can personally find. And when she claims to be a professional psychologist, especially on something as formal as LinkedIn, that causes confusion for ordinary people that don't know all the ins and outs when it comes to something as serious as this. And then this comes all the way back to the Rewired Soul as a channel and a brand. Because Chris put up a live stream called My Psychologist Mom and I Debate. And when random members of the public see psychologist, they presume that the psychologist is licensed, especially when Chris and Carrie say things like this.
When I was doing groups, I'm like, if you're here and not paying attention, you are wasting your fucking time.
I know.
So that's another reason why I say, you know what I mean? Hey, Julia.
And I think another reason I don't do that so much is because when you're in the profession, there's a lot of, you could get in a lot of trouble for, their patients have rights. There's a patient right thing. So you have to watch how you talk to them.
That was one of the best things is that I wasn't like a licensed therapist. I could say whatever. And the same thing on my YouTube channel. Like everybody's like, what are your credentials? I'm like, bitch, I don't got none. I can say whatever the fuck I want and you can do whatever you want with that information.
Right.
It is so nice. I am living the dream. People ask me like, oh, what's your degree in? I'm like, I don't got one. I barely graduated high school, dropped out of college twice.
I'm sorry to laugh, but he is so 100% right. Did you know giving advice without credentials is safer?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. It's safer than giving it with credentials. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We're moving. Maybe we should just.
No, my mom's always saying that. Like, whenever we're tossing around ideas, she's like, oh, I don't know if I can say this. I don't know if I can say that. And she makes me word stuff a certain way. I'm like, God, it is nice being me. It is so good to be me. Ain't no, like, committee coming after me. You know? No.
Stop it.
I can't get in trouble with the APA. Can't get in trouble with ASAM. Can't get in trouble with fucking, like, I had to be mindful of HIPAA because I was working at a facility.
I'm sorry to laugh, guys, but you have no idea how true that is.
Yeah.
Chris talks and Carrie laughs about him not being able to get into trouble with the APA, where Carrie states that it's hard to speak with credentials, all to paint a subtly suggested picture that she's fully licensed, completely unlike Chris. I'm sorry, but for me, that is really, really misleading, and considering what the APA says, it sounds like a violation of their ethics. But it's not always so subtle.
So
it's very addicting.
So a psychologist, why would you see a psychologist rather than a therapist? Like just like an LCSW or LFM.
A psychologist can do more psych testing or we can do psychological testing. So if there's a diagnosis that we're not sure of, we can take it to a next level. But we do therapy just like an LCSW, MFT. We're just trained more in psychological theory and psych testing.
Yeah, she was saying something in this book. It seems like I'm promoting a book. I already did a book review of Katie Morton's book. Did any of you read it? I don't know. Did any of you read my book? Rewire Your Anger? My mom hasn't even read it, just so you know. But anyways, like she was saying that psychologists do more, like there's like PsyD and then there's PhD.
Right.
And like one of them does more like testing and is with data.
PhD.
Is that what you do?
I'm a PhD.
Okay.
But it just matters what field you get in. I'm in addiction, so I don't do any of that. But
yeah. Someone said, can a therapist still help me?
Of course they can. Yes, definitely. Yeah.
So this is something that I've just found out about in the last few weeks. Are there some like therapists and psychologists who do not give you like shit to work on when you're not in their office?
Right, because it matters what theoretical model you're coming from. So like right now I see somebody says, I feel like psychologists diagnose therapists, counselors talk. No, many of us do therapy. All my girlfriends and my guy friends that are psychologists, most of us are in the trenches doing the counseling and therapy now.
Yeah.
So a lot of us are doing the therapy.
But like,
however, counselors diagnose too. We all do.
When Carrie says we when talking about psychologists, but they when talking about therapists, she made a distinction between them. Psychologists and therapists are different according to her. To me, and most likely to anyone else hearing that, it sounds like she's implying that she is with the licensed psychologist group and not with the therapist group. If I didn't know of Carrie and heard that clip, I would presume that she was a licensed psychologist. I'd presume that she was saying that she was much more qualified than a standard therapist. According to the APA, it's against their ethics to have ordinary people confused about licensing and credentials. That's where this whole problem lies. But let's get back to the comparison. Peter Monn claimed that he was a psychotherapist, and that was a lie by omission in exactly the same way, right? Well, actually, no. I reached out to Peter to ask him myself, and he was kind enough to provide me with personal receipts. I am not going to be blasting highly personal information here, but I will be explaining what I now know to be true. So, Peter worked in a treatment center back in May 1995 to January 2008. He achieved his master's degree in social work back in 1999 during his time at work at the center under supervision by both clinical and medical supervisors. During that time, he was required to keep studying for continued education credits to keep working. Since psychotherapists can be social workers too, as a counselor with a master's background in social work, Peter was accurate in using that title at the time. But the laws have massively changed since then in the state of Indiana. But anyway, when Peter left to start his own practice, he still worked under supervision until he decided to move on to life coaching, which doesn't need any kind of licensing at all. But that was all fully disclosed exactly the way that it should have been. Comparing Peter to Carrie, well, there's just no comparison at all. Peter worked entirely legally. He moved on in his career, he did some life coaching, and joined YouTube to do his thing. It was all totally cut and dried, and even though he talks about his past and his own experience across his different YouTube channels, that's just, you know, Peter. It's not a cash grab. On the other hand, Carrie is out there potentially misleading consumers and attempting to cash in via both the Rewired Souls website and now on Patreon. But Carrie hasn't just been trying this kind of Patreon cash brag online, allegedly. Corey Siren has very kindly helped me with some research, and both her channel and Twitter are linked down below. Thank you very much, Corey. She decided to call Touchstone to get some answers for herself. For privacy and legal reasons, the best that I can do is give you the basic gist of the conversation relayed to me, but I am going to say right now that I completely, 100% personally trust that what Corey told me was accurate. So, Corey spoke with a Touchstone employee, let's call them X. After some general conversation about what Touchstone does, Corey asked about Dr. Carrie Randazzo. Unfortunately, X didn't know Carrie personally, but when pressed, they said that Carrie was a director at Touchstone, but that when she left, the doctor, the original owner of the business, took over her position. X wasn't sure about Carrie's credentials, but stated that they didn't think that Carrie was licensed. As far as X knew, Carrie was doing, quote, sobriety coaching. Much more shockingly though, and completely unprompted, X stated that the last that they heard, Carrie tried a Skype kind of deal, where Carrie was allegedly supposed to have been asking for memberships and subscriptions to pay for one-on-one sessions online, describing the practice as, I quote, funky. Corey did ask whether what was alleged was legal, but X said that they didn't know. Now, it's very reasonable to think that what X stated was just a rumor that they'd heard, but it would be a very strange coincidence for some random person to talk about Skype sessions and for Carrie to try starting a Patreon where a tier includes a one-on-one session online. In fairness, maybe that's just what the person was thinking about, but that uneasy conversation about her is very telling to me. Peter was a life coach. If Carrie is providing sobriety coaching, again, that would put them in the same kind of bracket. But considering how coy Carrie has been about her credentials online, where there are a ton of unanswered questions and presumptions made, I personally worry whether she's being 100% honest with clients out there. When I spoke to Peter, he told me explicitly, without any questioning about the practice from me, that it was his job to be completely clear with his clients when life coaching and tell them before they even started together that he wasn't licensed, along with the differences between life coaching and therapy. If that's really what's going on with Carrie, then I genuinely hope that she is being 100% honest with our clients and potential clients about what our credentials truly are. Because according to the California Board of Psychology, it really looks as though even if someone accidentally forgets to register with them while they're practicing while supervised, then the state could prosecute for practicing psychology without a license. They are really, really strict about this, apparently. This is even more disturbing now that it's been confirmed by Chris himself that Carrie isn't licensed, yet they've both been heavily implying that she has been licensed for a long time now. In What I Learned from a Real Mental Health Professional featuring Dr. Todd Grande, Chris had this to say.
So the first thing I want to do, just to get this out of the way, there's been some conversations around my mother, Dr. Carrie Randazzo, and I just wanted to get just have you help explain to the audience about credentials and licensure and things like that, even though it varies from state to state. So my mother has a PhD in psychology. She's currently not licensed, but she's built an amazing reputation over the last 20 years. She's been a clinical director of an intensive outpatient treatment center. She's actually speaking at the CCAPP conference, which is an addiction conference in California.
That really isn't a good look. Now, for those of you wondering why I've focused so much on Dr. Carrie Randazzo and less on Chris Boutte, or say that's unfair or wrong, I need to make this 100% clear. And Chris has been co-signing his mother not being completely honest when she should be. Chris and Carrie work together with the Rewired Soul. This is not an attack against his mother because she happens to be his mother, like Chris wants you to believe. Considering just how much Chris uses his mother as an excuse to say that he knows better than a lot of therapists, considering they're part of the same brand, it's only fair to look into her too. Now I'm really glad that I did, because the truth has been confirmed. I really can't talk about specific laws that may or may not have been broken, but this looks really serious, and I think it's only fair for this whole situation to be investigated fully by the proper authorities, just so everyone is protected. Chris, Carrie, clients, everyone needs protection and the truth. But what I will say is this. The comparison between Peter Monn and the Rewired Soul as a brand is totally unfair. Like Chris, Peter put gross things out there onto social media. Unlike Chris, he actually apologized for them. Like Carrie, Peter has worked in a clinic. Unlike Carrie, he's been 100% transparent with his credentials. Unlike both of them, Peter has never price gouged his subscribers. Has he done wrong? Has he hurt people on a personal basis? Absolutely. But do I think that he cares, feels bad about it, and genuinely wants to better himself? Yes. Yes, I actually do, surprisingly enough. There is such a massive difference between friendships breaking down and bad behavior on a personal, one-on-one level and a creator using and abusing their audience, especially when that audience is vulnerable. And unlike the Rewired Soul, I don't think that Peter is all about the money. We can argue about advert breaks and videos all day long, but if in doubt, ad blockers are right there for viewers to use. And unlike Chris and Carrie, I genuinely believe that Peter cares about people in recovery. As far as I see it, Chris and Carrie only see cash cows. Even now, Chris has deliberately misrepresented what actual professionals have said about him to make himself look good. No, sorry Chris, but just because something may technically be legal, that doesn't mean that others can't call out what we see as harmful, unethical, or immoral. It's not illegal for beauty companies to only come out with foundation shades catering to people that hide in the snow for a living either, but they get rightfully dragged. Saying that something isn't illegal isn't a defense. So, to end this accidental Shane Dawson, I'm not about cancelled culture unless it's something deadly serious. Like I've said before, if Chris and Carrie are transparent, if they apologize, and if they take accountability, if they make amends, then good for them and I'll wish them success. Until then, I don't think that they're worth a damn thing. But please, don't compare them to Peter Monn. Peter absolutely, 100%, doesn't deserve it, no matter what you think of him, love or hate. Fair's fair, guys. If nothing else, I want us to always look at the bigger picture. Take a deep breath, ditch all of the personal bias, and just be fair. Special thanks to Corey Siren, and again, her links are in the description along with everything else. And thank you guys for watching. As always, like, comment, subscribe, ring the bell, or don't do any of those things because I'm not your mother. And, as we say in The Sims, dag dag!